Well, thank you again, and thank you for being here. As we honor mothers and honor Mother's Day, I want to share something very special with you, a word from the Lord for you. But have you noticed how much smarter mothers are sometimes than fathers? I mean, it really is amazing to me when I think about how smart my wife is, how smart my mother was, how smart your mother is, how smart all mothers are. Mothers are just smart people. Smart, not smart Alex. That's for the fathers, right? But so a little girl asked her mother one day, "Mommy, how did the human race start? Where did we all come from?" The mother answered, "Well, darling, God created Adam and Eve, and they had children, and then their children had children, and so we all came from them." 2 days later, the girl went to her father and asked her father the same question. The father said, "Well, darling, thank you for asking. Many years ago, you see, there were monkeys from which the human race evolved, and we all came from them." Now the little girl is confused, and she returns to her mother and said, "Mommy, how is it possible that you told me that the human race was created by God, but Daddy told me we all came from monkeys?" The mother looked without hesitation and said, "Oh, darling, that's simple. You see, I told you about my side of the family. Your father told you about his side of the family." Hey, mothers are so smart. Mothers are so smart. Don't doubt me. I'm telling you, it's the truth. I love you guys. Hope that went over good. I can't tell. So it probably didn't, but it's okay. I'm not here as a comedian. I'm here as a preacher, and I'm ready to preach. All right, you ready? All right, praise God. I want to talk to you about something that's on my heart, and what I've titled this teaching as is never alone, never alone, never alone. You know, Mother Teresa said that, and now Mother Teresa, everybody knows how influential she was. She spent years and decades in India, in the poorest parts of India, in the poorest parts of the world. And she was known as one of the most loving, generous people on earth. I mean, when you compare, you know, yourself to her, I mean, you forget it. You know, it's over. It's over before the gun, you know, before the start signal goes off, right? You know what I'm talking about. Mother Teresa. So she saw the suffering, and she saw the need, and she saw people in their absolute worst. And Mother Teresa said, after seeing everything and the effect of poverty, she said, loneliness is the most terrible poverty. Loneliness and the feelings of loneliness is the single most terrible poverty. It's the poorest that anybody could ever feel. Like, you could go without all the extras and all the luxury and all the, you could even go without fancy food. You could live off crackers and water. If you weren't lonely, it wouldn't matter what you ate. Loneliness, she said, is the worst of all poverty. And so I want to talk to you about that a little bit. And I want to talk to you about what's going on in the world today. And I want to talk to you about why, this is so important, and how we need to be aware of what's going on in our soul and what's going on in the souls of others. Because, you know, no matter what the government does, the government is never going to be able to feed you spiritually and emotionally. The care for your soul is between you and God and your church. That's what a church is for, is to care for the soul of people. Now, we feed a lot of people, and we help a lot of people, and we visit so many, but the soul care is what you're really after, and what we're really here for is because when the soul is healthy, the Bible says, "Beloved, I wish above all things that you would prosper and be in health, even as your soul prospers," in 3 John verse 2. So as your soul goes, so goes your whole life. So goes the rest of you. It follows the pattern of your soul. Soul health equals whole health. When your soul is healthy, the rest of your life will be healthy in every area. And the thing that robs people of soul health is loneliness. One of the things that robs you of emotional well-being is that feeling of loneliness. How many of us have ever felt that loneliness deficit? Perhaps you felt the absence of love. And I want to share with you some of the consequences of loneliness when it comes to our health. Studies have been done, and I'm giving you a study from January of 2020. So this is the most recent studies, and then I'll give you something that even came out in April. But the health consequences of loneliness are often likened to or compared to the effects of a person smoking 15 cigarettes a day. So think about this. If a person smokes 16 cigarettes a day and the damage that that does to the body, loneliness does to the soul. And a January report from Cigna Insurance Company suggests that about 60% of American adults, 60% of American adults felt some degree or higher degree of loneliness even before the COVID-19 pandemic hit. Now, if you want to be startled with these statistics, let me give you something that will, probably surprise you, but maybe it won't, because you feel some of this in your soul. And we're going to address that, and God's going to heal us, and God's going to fill us. And today is your day. Today, we're getting to the other side. We're going to the other side today. But watch this, that 50%. So the Cigna went on in this study, this is January 2020, and found that 50% of people aged 52 to 72 had a higher degree of loneliness. They were experiencing loneliness. 52 years old to 72, half, 50% of them experiencing loneliness. 65% of those aged 38 to 51, 65% aged 38 to 51. 72% of those aged 23 to 38, you see how the pattern? It's the younger people are, the more lonely they are. 72% of those aged 23 to 38 were experiencing significant loneliness. And listen, you want to know about the ages of 18 to 22? The years we think is so much fun and we have so many friends. 80% of people aged 18 to 22 were experiencing significant loneliness, according to this study. Now, that was in January before the pandemic hit. Now listen to this. Since the lockdowns and the stay-at-home orders were instated, an April 2020 survey revealed, listen to this, we're already averaging 60% of all adults, not to mention all the children that feel lonely, 60% of all adults on the average from 18 to 72, the average comes out to 60%, 60. But since the lockdowns and the stay-at-home orders were instated, an April 2020 survey revealed 47%, so we're talking about half of those people, half of all American adults reported feeling lonelier than they did, than usual, even lonelier than the already condition that they were in, where 60%. Now 40%, everybody feels 40% more lonely than they did before the pandemic hit. And that's people that are staying at home. One lady, a 41-year-old mother, married mother. See, sometimes we think if you live alone, now I think a statistic is something like 35% of adults in America live by themselves. 35%, I think I read that. It's close. If it's not that exact number, it's close. It may be a few percentages more of people that live by themselves. But this 41-year-old married mother spent the last 2 months at home in New Orleans with her husband and her three young kids. But she says she's never felt more alone. She says she has zero emotional energy for self-care since she's juggling work, homeschooling, and regular parenting that existed before the pandemic, and now all these other things afterwards, while dealing with paralyzing stress and anxiety, she called it. She's dealing with paralyzing stress and anxiety, and she said, and guilt for feeling overwhelmed when so many people are worse off than me. I want you to hear this. Here's a person that feels more alone than ever, and yet has a husband and has children. So loneliness is hitting everybody. Waves of loneliness is existing in this world. We can't imagine if you're not experiencing that, if you haven't experienced what it feels to be lonely. I don't mean to be alone, because some people can be alone but not lonely. But to have all those things and then to feel the guilt, to have a husband and to have children and to have a job, and she still feels more alone than ever. Imagine not having those things. How much worse a person might feel. And then she feels the guilt on top of it, knowing that so many people are worse off than her. See, we're dealing with an epidemic called loneliness. We were already dealing with it. Don't you see the first statistics I gave you were before. They were in January of this year. Then after, it's 47% higher. So it's 50% higher, generally speaking, rounding it off. Why is that? Because people are lonely inside. You could be around people, but you're lonely inside. People don't want to feel that loneliness. Aristotle, the great philosopher, said, "No one would choose a friendless existence, even if offered all the other things in the world, money and fame and everything. No one would choose a friendless existence, even if offered all the other things in the world." He said, "There were many that would rather meet their bitterest enemy in the field than to meet their own heart, their own lonely heart in the closet." Think about what he said. There are many that would rather meet their bitterest enemy in a field of battle than to meet their own heart of loneliness in the closet. You know, in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11, and I want to read this to you, I think from the New King James Bible. It says about God, "He has made everything beautiful in its time." Can we just pause for a moment and let me double click on that word right there. He made everything beautiful in its time. You know, humans have a bad relationship with time. We have a bad relationship with time. We want things fast. We want things over. We want things now. We have a bad relationship with time. Time is not your enemy. Because you want to know, there used to be a song, "Time is on my side." Yes, it is. I know I lost a few people watching right there. I'm so sorry. Come back, please. Oh, it's by the Rolling Stones, I think, now that I'm like replaying it in my head. You know, what I do in between sentences, a lot of stuff's happening in there. Wheels are turning, machines are going crazy in there, man. You don't want to get in there. I'm just trying to get the good stuff out. All right. So he's made everything beautiful in his time. In other words, time is not your enemy. Time is on your side because God's on your side, and God created time. And so we have to stop viewing time as our enemy. Well, if it doesn't happen now, man, in one moment, God can turn around years of frustration in your life. In one split second, the hand of God, the fingers of God, the power of God, the Spirit of God can transform your situation. Took years to get in the problem, took years to create a problem, took years to create addiction. God can change you in one split second. He did it for me. I was lonely at 17 years old. Jesus came into my life. He changed it all in a split second. And then everything else started changing, but my spirit was brand new immediately. I had hope for the first time in my life. I felt the love of God for the first time in my life. God can change anything in one split second. He can make up for you in one moment what you lost over the last 20 or 30 or 40 or 50 years. We need to stop having a bad relationship with time. If you guys could keep that scripture up, I want you to see this. He has made everything beautiful in its time. You know, I think we need to kiss and make up with time. We need to stop having such a bad relationship with it. And we need to start bringing it close and knowing that if you'll give God time, He will give you beauty. Did you hear me? If you give God time, He will give you beauty. Can we just stop right now and just give Him our time? And just say, "Heavenly Father, I give you my time. I give you my trust. I give you all of my pain, all of my shame, all of my problems, all of my unanswered prayers, all of my unanswered questions, all of my needs. I put them in your hands, and I trust you that what I give you, by giving you time, you will give me beauty. By giving you time, you will give me beauty. He has made everything beautiful in its time. It's not too late. It wasn't too late for Abraham. And he had a kid at 99 years old. It wasn't too late for Sarah, and she had a kid at 90 years old. It wasn't too late for Peter. He denied the Lord three times, but Jesus took him back. It wasn't too late for Saul, who was killing people and rejoicing at the death of Christians. He was already a Pharisee, already a Sadducee, already a religious leader. He was breathing threats continually against the church, against Christians. And in one split second on the road to Damascus, Jesus stopped him and said, "Why are you persecuting me? I want you to follow me. I want you to trust me. I want you to surrender to me." And for the first time, the very man who was the greatest enemy of the church, in one split second, became the greatest friend of the church, next to Jesus himself. And then he says, in this verse, let's trust God with our time. That was a special moment. I hope you received that. Also, he has put eternity in their hearts. He has put eternity in their hearts, except that no man can find out, no one can find out the work that God does from beginning to end. In other words, no one can fully understand how God does it and what God does inside of the human heart, but he has put eternity in there. In other words, the hole inside of people that makes them feel lonely, it's not human shaped. The hole inside of you is not, it's not shaped as a human. It's God shaped. You see, the only thing that can fill an eternal hole, because God has put eternity in their hearts, so the only thing that can fill an eternal heart is an eternal God. Where's that scripture that says, "Unto the King, eternal, immortal, invincible"? Unto him, the eternal, the immortal, the invincible. That's our God. That's our Savior. That's the God who saved you. 1 Timothy 1:17 is the verse that says, "Now unto the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, to God who alone is wise, be honor and glory forever and ever." Woo! The hole inside of you, you can try to fill it up. I tried to fill it up with drugs. I tried to fill it up with alcohol. I tried to fill it up with all sorts of needs, lusts, and it just kept going. Just kept draining out. Anytime you'd fill it with something, because an eternal hole can't be filled with something temporary. Eternity and temporary are the exact opposites. So whatever is eternal inside of you cannot be satisfied with something temporary. What is it? The eternal hole can only be filled with an eternal God. Your heart is eternal. And the reason why there's such loneliness in this world is because we're trying to fill an eternal hole with temporary things. And it just can't fill it. It can't fill it. But God can, and God will, and God does, and God has, and God is going to fill you today if you're feeling lonely at all. The world is filled with so many unhealthy relationships because we're trying to get from each other what only God can give us. We're trying to get from each other what only God can give us. In fact, we get angry at people because they didn't give us what we're trying to get from them. And in many cases, that's probably the best thing that can happen to us, is to be disappointed by temporary things and temporary people so that we are awakened to the fact that I'm still empty. How many people have had the most success in life, they've had businesses, they've been celebrities, they've had money, they've had the, you know, prettiest and handsomest boyfriends and girlfriends, and they've had all the friends and all the fame and all the accolades, and yet they're still lonely. Because if you got all of those things and tried to fill your life with them, that's why they're still looking. That's why celebrities are always looking for another cause to represent and stand for. They're empty inside. Fame can't fill you. Money can't fill you. Sex can't fill you. People can't fill you. Your whole inside is eternal. Only God can fill that. Only His love. Only His love. Because His love never fails. You know, John Milton, the great author, Paradise Lost, he said this: loneliness was the first thing that God saw that was not good. You know, throughout Genesis chapter 1, after God created everything the first day, God saw that it was good. Second day, God saw that it was good. Third day, God saw that it was good. Fourth day, God saw that it was good. Fifth day, God saw that it was good. Sixth day, God saw that it was good, saw that it was very good. But what wasn't good? Genesis 2:18, let me show you what wasn't good. The Lord God said, it's not good for the man to be alone. So what am I going to do? I'm going to make him a helper. I'm going to make him a helper. And what did he do? He took, verse 19 says, so he put the man to sleep. And verse 20 says he took the rib out of his side and fashioned it into a woman and put them together. And the helper came from within Adam's side. The helper came from within. And then it was God put the helper out next to him. But the helper came from within. What am I trying to say? If you look at John 14, verse 16, I want to show you the helper that came to help you. I will ask the Father, Jesus said in John 14, 16, I will ask the Father and He will give you another helper. He'll give you another helper. He'll give you another helper that He may be with you for how long? Forever. What's forever? Eternity. What's God put in our hearts? Eternity. The Holy Spirit is who He's talking about here. The Holy Spirit. Listen to me. It's so important you hear this. There's two creations that have taken place in human history by God. The first creation was Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, where God took the helper out from within Adam and placed the helper next to Adam, Eve. That's the first creation. The second creation is called the new creation. It says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. The old things passed away and all things have become new. So in the new creation, God doesn't take from within us and put the helper next to us. God takes the helper from heaven and puts the helper inside of us. So now the old creation, the first creation, He takes the helper out and puts Eve next to Him. But in the new creation, He takes the helper from heaven and puts the helper in man. And now when you're born again, the Holy Spirit doesn't operate next to you. He operates in you. 2 Corinthians 3:18 says, or chapter 3, verse 16, I think it is. He says, or 1 Corinthians, excuse me. Did I not say to you, do you not know that you are the temple of the Holy Spirit and that God dwells in you? Whoa, this is the problem with believers. Do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? He doesn't say, do you not have the Spirit of God dwelling in you? That's not the question. He says, do you not know that you are the temple of God and the Spirit of God dwells in you? What spirit? Romans 8:11. Watch this now. Which spirit dwells in you? Romans 8:11 says, but if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead, that's the Holy Spirit, dwells in you, that's the Holy Spirit dwelling in you, he who raised Jesus from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who indwells you. So listen, gang, the one that we're talking about here, the one who will help us, the one who will satisfy the loneliness, the one who will take away our pain, the one who will comfort us in our midnight hour, the one who will be with us when everybody forsakes us. He's the Holy Spirit. He's the Holy Spirit. And he dwells inside. If you're born again, he dwells inside of you. It's just our lack of knowledge. Do you not know? He said, do you not know? So they didn't know. They had him, but they didn't know. And they didn't know how to activate the power of the Holy Spirit, which we'll talk about in a moment before we close. I want to read to you John chapter 16, verse 7. John chapter 16, verse 7. Sometimes it's a blessing, folks, for a person to disappoint you, because your loneliness is an invitation from God to fill you. Your loneliness is an invitation from God to comfort you. The loneliness is an invitation from God, because we weren't designed, the eternity in our heart was not designed for people to be able to fill us. Eternity in your heart was designed for the Holy Spirit, the eternal God, to fill us. Look at what Jesus said in verse 7 of John 16. He said, but I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away, for if I don't go away, the Helper will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. So when Jesus rose from the dead and then he ascended to heaven, guess what he sent? The Holy Spirit. And what does he call him? The Helper. Look at what he calls him in the Amplified Bible. He says, the Helper, the Comforter. I'm going to give you seven names for him. The Helper, the Comforter, the Intercessor. There's two versions of the Amplified Bible. I'm reading from one of them. The Helper, the Comforter, the Advocate, the Intercessor, the Counselor, the Strengthener, the Standby. There are seven things. Notice the seven things that the Holy Spirit does as our Helper. Number one, he helps us. He helps us. Man, there's times in our lives, most of the time in our life, we need help. How about this one? Romans 8, 26 says, for the Holy Spirit helps our weaknesses. You can put this one in the regular version if you can put it on the screen. In the same way, the Spirit helps our weakness. For we do not know how to pray as we should, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us. We do not know how to pray as we should, but the Spirit himself. This is why the activity of the Holy Spirit, God wants the Holy Spirit active in your life. He helps our weakness. He helps our weakness. He helps. The first thing the Holy Spirit does is he helps us. He helps us where? He helps us to know Jesus. He helps us in our weakness. He helps us in our inability to know how to overcome. The Holy Spirit makes us more than conquerors. The Holy Spirit fills us with God's love. Romans 5:5 says, the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit. Through the Holy Spirit, the love of God has been poured out within our hearts through the Holy Spirit who was given to us. Back to the seven things in John 16. Number one, he's the Helper. Number two, he's the Comforter. Hey, listen, somebody's going through some severe pain right now. Somebody's going through some grief right now. Somebody's going through some discouragement, despair. And the Holy Spirit, we're going to invite him to comfort you today. He's the Comforter. You know, some of us have grieved the loss of loved ones. Some of us, we've had family members that have had heart attacks. We've had family members that have died of cancer. There's so many people, everybody dies, but it's a grief when they do. It's grieving. It's so sad when it's somebody we loved and somebody we were close to. And yet the Bible says the Holy Spirit is our Comforter, number two. Number three, the Holy Spirit is our Advocate. That means he fights on our behalf. He's an advocate. He's like our lawyer. He's our defender. You don't need to defend yourself. The Holy Spirit will defend you. The Bible says, whenever you're delivered up to the enemy, don't worry about planning ahead what you're going to say. The Holy Spirit, in that hour, will give you what to say. He's our defender. Do you need somebody to defend you? Sometimes we're so defensive. If we just let down our guard and yield to the Holy Spirit and invite the Holy Spirit to defend us and to lead us, He'll do it. He'll do a better job than you could ever do for yourself. He's the defender. Number four, He's the intercessor. We just saw in Romans 8:26, He's the intercessor. The Bible says that we don't know how to pray as we should, but He intercedes for us. In Romans 8:26, He intercedes for you with groanings too deep for words. You know, He's talking about the gift of praying in tongues. Now, I know that some people that are watching me today, you've never heard of that, or you've never experienced it, or you've heard of it, and you remember your great-grandmother, you know, making crazy sounds, praying in tongues, some Pentecostal lady out of her mind. Well, she wasn't out of her mind because you're saved now. You better thank her for speaking in tongues. You better thank her for praying in tongues. Hey! And the gift of tongues is a beautiful, precious prayer language. The Bible talks about in 1 Corinthians 14, I will sing with my understanding and I will sing with my spirit. I will pray with my understanding, and I'll pray with my spirit. In other words, I'll pray with my spirit, I'll pray in my own language, and I'll pray in tongues. I'll sing in my own language and I'll sing in tongues. This is not me trying to shove this down anybody's throat. This is a beautiful gift that if you'll ask God for it, this precious gift of tongues, the baptism in the Holy Spirit, I know I wouldn't have made it this far. I got a long way to go, but I wouldn't have made it this far in my life without the beautiful gift of praying in tongues. And that's not my point today to dwell on that, but if you want more information on that, you can download a copy of our book, The Power of a New Life, and it's for free as my gift to you. And in it, there's a chapter on the gift of the Holy Spirit, and you can follow the scriptures and follow God's beautiful promise of praying in the Holy Spirit, the beautiful gift of tongues. And if you want, call our office and somebody will pray with you. If you'd like to say, hey, I would like to have somebody pray with me to have the baptism in the Holy Spirit. It's not the same as baptism in water. It's the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The word means immersed. It's the immersion in the Holy Spirit. And God will give you that. If you want to call us, one of our prayer partners will pray with you. And if you can't get through, they'll call you back, leave your information. 847-645-1070 is the number to our prayer line. 847-645-1070 or 9100, same, get you the same. All right, so He's our intercessor. Man, there's sometimes I don't know what to pray. So I just start praying in tongues and God starts working through prayer. He's our counselor, number five. You know, I'm all for 12 steps. I'm all for professional counseling when it's needed. I don't believe there's any shame in that. There's no reason to ever be ashamed to go to a 12 steps program or to get counseling or to have a therapist. But what I want you to know is the greatest counselor lives inside of you. His name is the Holy Spirit. And He says here, the fifth thing He is He's our counselor. So ask Him, Lord, give me the counsel that I need. Give me the counseling that I need for this marriage to work. Give me the counseling I need to help my child through this. Give me the counseling I need to help me recover from this addiction. Give me the counseling I need. I invite the Holy Spirit, you see, and I believe the Holy Spirit can work through some of those other things as well. But what I'm saying is the Holy Spirit has counsel that this world knows not of. There's a counselor inside of you. You know what? In fact, if you want to know how He describes Himself, He's the wonderful counselor. He'll give you wonderful counsel. I've had counselors. I've been with counselors. I've spent hours and hours over my lifetime with counselors that weren't wonderful. I have counseled for thousands of hours to people in my lifetime, and I can guarantee you many of those hours I was not a wonderful counselor. I was a counselor, just not a wonderful one. And I apologize if you were the victim of my lack of wonder There was no signs and wonders to my counsel. It was bad sometimes. Forgive me. God help you. God help me. God help us all. He's the wonderful counselor. He's the strengthener. It's the sixth thing. The Holy Spirit is the strengthener. He'll strengthen you. That's a simple teaching. I get it. It's not fancy preaching, but this is the help we need. He's our strengthener. He'll give strength to the weary. Though youths grow weary and vigorous young men stumble badly, yet those who wait upon the Lord, he will give them strength. He will exchange strength is what it means. He will exchange his strength for ours. You see, all of Christianity is an exchange. We exchange our sins for his righteousness. We exchange our sickness for his healing. We exchange our curses for his blessing. We exchange our weaknesses for his strength. What a God, the Holy Spirit. He's our strengthener. Do you need strength today? Do you feel like giving up? He'll strengthen you. And number seven, he's our standby. What does it mean to stand by? It means he will always stand by you. He will never leave you. Look at what it says in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5 and 6 in the Amplified Bible. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5 and 6. He will never leave you. He says, let your character be free from the love of money, greed, lust, cravings, and be satisfied with your present circumstances. Learn contentment is what he's saying, and with what you have. For he himself has said, I will not in any way fail you, nor give you up, nor leave you without support. I will not, I will not, I will not in any degree leave you helpless, nor forsake you, nor let you down, nor relax my hold on you. Assuredly not. Assuredly not. That's why the Bible says we can take comfort and we can be encouraged and we can boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. I will not fear or dread or be terrified. What can man do to me? The Lord is my helper. It's the Holy Spirit. If you're not born again today, I want to pray with you right now. If you never accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior and Lord, I want to pray with you right now. Would you pray this out loud after me? And then I'll pray for the rest of us who are already born again. Just say this, Heavenly Father, I invite Jesus Christ into my life as my Savior and Lord. I believe Jesus died for my sins. That's it, just say that. I believe Jesus died for my sins and rose from the dead. From this moment forward, I'm a child of God. If you prayed that prayer, congratulations. You just made the greatest decision anybody could ever make in your life to receive Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. Wow, you're in the family of God now. The Bible says in Psalm 68, verse 5, God sets the lonely in families. You're in the family of God now. You never have to be alone or lonely another day in your life. I have a book for you. It's called The Power of a New Life. I want to send it to you as my gift. You can download it or we'll send it to you in the mail. If you just got saved, if you just accepted Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord, we'll actually send you a copy. If you're already saved and you want a copy of that, you can download it for free as well online. And I just welcome you, those of you that got saved, into the family of God. Now, the Holy Spirit, come on, let's invite him to operate in our lives. Let's just pray, everybody pray this. Say, Heavenly Father, I thank you that the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead lives inside of me. And now I invite the Holy Spirit to help me, comfort me, defend me, intercede for me, counsel me, strengthen me, stand by me. I know you'll never leave me. You'll never let me go. You'll never abandon me. You'll never forsake me. Thank you in Jesus' name. Now I bless you in the name of Jesus. And I'd like to end this service with a gift to the mothers and to everybody, a special song that we did And I want you to experience that moment of the blessing. And I want you to feel the waves of God's love and the waves of God's blessing hit you, change you, touch you, heal you, minister and bless you, every part of your life touched by God. Enjoy this moment together.
See you. Praise God.
May his favor
Thank you, Jesus.
Be upon you and your children.
Thank you, Jesus.
And their children. And their children. Spirit, soul, body, financial. We bless you.
Thank you,
in the
Jesus.
Name of Jesus, bless and grace.
We declare the blessing of God upon your household, upon your children. We declare healing, freedom from pain, freedom from sorrow, freedom from depression, freedom from disease, freedom from viruses. We declare a hedge of protection around your home, around your loved ones, and we are coming into our best days ever. Your next days are your best days. We are smiling at the future together because God is with you. Jesus is with you. The Holy
bless you and keep you, and his favor will surround you like a shield. We love you. God bless you. We'll see you Wednesday night or every day this week. Thank you for joining us. Happy Mother's Day, moms. God bless.